you're going to have to do something, because it's your thing.
As you know, I hate starting, so we just say hi, welcome to IT Designs, and you know, then we'll see what happens.
Cool.
It's not happening, Dave. Hi, welcome to IT Idiots, episode 71. My name's Nicky Curtis.
And I'm Dave Morgan.
Hi, we're back, so after about a year.
Yep.
So,
And for anyone out there who's seen some of the previous ones, maybe we should point out that I'm not actually Nick.
You're not actually Nick, and we might have had Nick on the titles. It depends if you could be bothered to do something
about
that.
We'll find out sooner rather than later whether Nick will be on the titles but not in the podcast. So, yeah, but I'm definitely not Nick.
Definitely not Nick, he's Dave. It's a fact. Okay. Right, so what are we doing today, Dave?
Today, I think we're going to do Windows 7 deployments using MDT 2010.
Cool. So is that finally out then, MDT 2010?
MDT 2010 is out, yeah. So okay. It's just waiting now for the official release of Windows 7, which will be coming up sometime soon.
Cool. So I noticed our last episode, we actually did Windows 7, and that was at the 2nd of January this year, so that must probably be the early beta.
It's almost as if it's flowing on nicely.
So it's flowing, yeah, we were waiting for this. So MDT, Microsoft Deployment Toolkit, is basically a way to deploy Windows 7, is it not?
It is. It gives you the ability to do what's called light touch deployments. Uh-huh. So in the same way that you would have done with, say, Ghost, when you'd boot off some media or Pixie boot, and then it would go off and deploy the image as you wanted it to.
Cool, and it's totally free?
Totally free. It's one of the few free things from Microsoft, so it's a good tool to use.
Okay, and so why would I buy Ghost then?
That's a good one for Semantic to answer. We should get someone in to talk about it.
Yeah, so it's probably worth talking about, because Microsoft Deployment Toolkit, I don't think there's that many people know about it, do they? Well, it surprises me the amount of people who still use Ghost.
Yeah.
Now, I'm never knocking Ghost, because it was pretty good for its time, but with all the things we're dealing with now, when you're deploying a new operating system, you're dealing with new driver injections, aren't you? And the trouble with Ghost is it used to keep the drivers in the build, and it used to make the build age.
Yeah, and you also used to have normally multiple different builds for all of your hardware models. And we were somewhere a couple of weeks ago when they had 23 different builds. And, I mean, 23 builds is a lot to be dealing with.
It is a lot.
So if we can get that down to one build and then throw some apps on afterwards.
I said 23 builds, that sounds like VJ.
or Moody.
Or Moody. Anyway, moving on. Yeah, so Dave's going to take us through MDT 2010, and the first initial podcast is just going to be a light touch install.
It is.
However, just want to say MDT 2010 can do so much more than that. It can do a zero touch install. It can integrate with System Center Config Manager, all of which Dave's done. It's all sitting in the back room, but we thought we'd start easy and see what we can get on.
Absolutely. So, first of all, I'll have a sip from my nice mug.
Your nice pink mug. Strange you went for the pink mug, eh?
Well, as you're well aware, Nicky, there was only one mug left after you went in there and stole
the Bart Simpson mug.
Yeah.
Okay.
So whoever's mug that is, they're going to be wondering what it's doing on a podcast.
I don't know whose it is, to be honest.
I think it might be Elliot's.
Elliot's?
Yeah.
Is it? Oh, shit. He doesn't watch podcasts.
So, yes, okay. So first things first, MDT is already installed on this location. It's a very simple installation. It's literally, you get the MSI, you press next, you're done. You then install the Windows Automated Installation Kit, which is Wake.
So what does Wake give us then? So why do I need Wake?
Yeah, you need Wake. It's a 1.6 gig ISO image download. But out of all of that, you need something they call the System Preparation Tool.
Okay.
And that's about 2 meg. You have to get the whole
ISO. So that's SysPrep then? Is it?
It's the equivalent of sort of the unattended build.
Gotcha.
Scripting tool. So we'll show you that, because we're going to have to change things from being American, because nobody wants to see their operating system in American, apart from maybe the Americans.
It'd probably suit you with this keyboard, though, to be honest.
I don't think I can set it to Spaz.
Yeah, keyboard. So we're using a Mac as usual, just because the capture software on it is
it's
just a
no,
little
it's
bit
got
cleaner.
No keys. It's got no hash key, it's got no Windows key. I'm all at sea here.
Right, so MDT 2010 is all installed, and you don't need anything special really to install it. It's just a file share, really, isn't it?
It is. I mean, it can be on anything. It doesn't even have to be on a server operating system if you're happy to have the sort of, you know, the 10 concurrent.
I mean, you're running on a Mac.
I mean, yes. there's no terminal server here. So what we'll do, we'll open up the new workbench. I know
this might be a few minutes while Dave gets used to running a Mac.
I can't do it, Nicky.
Okay.
I'm just going to press enter. What?
Is the right click seems to have stuck on, doesn't it?
It does. Let's go up here. There we go. Okay, so I seem to remember back in your podcast list that you've done BDD 2007.
Yep.
In 2007. So again, it was current at the time.
It was indeed.
So anyone who's seen that particular podcast will notice that MDT 2010 is actually slightly different. And the reason for that is BDD 2007 and MDT 2008, which were pretty much the same thing, gave you a limitation that your deployment share had to be where your distribution share was. So that's all well and good, but if you wanted to have distribution share here, like stored on this wonderful Mac, but you want to sort of have a couple of remote ones so that other users can get onto them, you couldn't really do that with the old version.
Okay.
So now we'll do it this way. So on the screen now, hopefully this is recording, otherwise it's going to be a pretty pointless podcast.
Shall I just check?
I think you might want to, just before we run out of...
Yeah, exactly.
...which we're going to pretend isn't there for the time.
Okay.
And we'll go through the whole process from creating the deployment share, importing the Windows 7 image from the Windows 7 media, getting some drivers installed into the image, getting an application to go down at build time, and then the task sequence to tie the whole thing together, drop it on probably a WDS server, so a Windows Deployment Services server, and then we'll attempt to pixie boot a machine with the new image.
All done in Hyper-V.
All done in Hyper-V.
But this time it's not my bedroom server. Some of you might notice that, my bedroom doesn't look like this, so we're actually at work, aren't we?
Yeah, I mean, we're doing quite well. We've got some expensive art on the wall behind us. We thought we might sort of snazz up the whole thing.
Is that actually in camera view?
I think it's behind me, so you look
is
like...
Is it snazzy, though? I mean, my art's better than that, to be honest, isn't it?
To be honest, it's in the eye of the beholder, isn't it? But that probably costs more than your car.
Yeah.
Probably. But who are we to say. Okay, so once I work out how to...
Do you want right-click? Right-click is hard. It's finger and two fingers and that.
Two fingers and
that. Two fingers and the click.
So everyone out there, this could take slightly longer than maybe we thought, so hopefully we've got enough tape in there. So the first thing we need to do really is create the new deployment share, which is going to be holding all of the files.
So this deployment share, can it hold multiple images? So
absolutely, you can have multiple images, you can have multiple task sequences.
Gotcha.
So it gives you the flexibility to deploy pretty much what you want.
So would I ever have two deployment shares on the same machine? These are real questions, by the way. I don't know.
That's good to know, because obviously this isn't what you do for a living.
No, it's not.
Yes, you could. For example, I was at a place which wanted complete separation between the task sequence which created the reference build and then captured the custom WIM, and the one which they'd give to their deployment people, because they don't accidentally want their deployment people pushing out a reference machine creation.
Might
confuse people. So yes, there are ways of doing it, and reasons why you might want to. So we'll create the new deployment share here on this machine. Delete button, Nicky.
That's that one.
I have to go that side of it.
Oh, okay. You want the delete run backspace.
Oh, dear. How do you...
Well, we could use ZD ScreenSoft next time.
Well, I'm just thinking that it doesn't seem to be allowing me to type.
Is it in focus?
Yes, there we go. Nicky. We're going to get complaints again. After the unwatchable...
No, this is all... I got told off.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
What happened?
For not putting any effort into it.
I mean, that kind of makes sense, because you didn't put any effort into it.
Not really, but... I might do tomorrow.
Did you put as much effort into it as buying your new suit?
Everyone's got bleach on that.
I was going to say, it's dangerous doing work in the office. Okay, so the deployment share path that we're going to call it is ITI, so obviously IT idiots, to differentiate it from anything else which may or may not be on this server. The deployment share again, we will call the share itself ITI. You'll notice it's made it hidden share, because nobody will actually have to go into the share. It's all going to be done via the boot CDs and the boot images, so hidden share is acceptable. Again, ITI share, just as a description, which will show up in the MMC itself. So there we go. Again, all of these next pages, which is ask if an image should be captured, we can modify all of this later on, and we'll demonstrate the two ways we can go around this. So we're going to say no to that. We're not going to ask the user to set the admin password. We're going to do that when we edit the Windows 7 image itself. So go past that. Product key. Now, this is always a killer for Vista and Windows 7. product keys, it's not like XP when you've got a volume license key. Mm-hmm. You've got two different types of keys now. You've got the multiple activation key.
The MAC key.
And then you've got the other one, which has slipped my mind at the moment.
You shouldn't know about this, Dave.
I should do, really. But we'll skip past. And
the MAC key and the other one.
The other one.
Okay.
So that's a technical term from Microsoft. If you ever see someone from Microsoft, just ask for the other one. It'll be fine. So we'll create the share now. Off it goes. Basically, all it's doing now is copying the scripts and the tools that it's going to use during its process into the right folder structure. And there we go, finished. So what I'll do, I'll now show you the folder structure so you can see roughly what it's created.
So again, I think you covered this before, but people can install this on their workstation at home.
This can be on a workstation.
You can install this on anything that hosts a share, really, can't you?
Pretty much, yeah. So we have ITI now, and we have a folder structure.
Okay.
So this is a folder structure which is going to be moving on. It's going to hold everything. So obviously operating systems will be in the operating systems folder.
It's quite intuitive.
I'll clarify that for you then. You might want to put them in boot. Or
I can't see that anyway from here.
So this is a folder structure which we've just created. So just something to keep aware.
And every deployment share, I take it, has that folder structure.
Every deployment share will be in this, in this sort of structure. So now if we have a look at what we have here. We have a number of sub-nodes which have come up. Now, if you notice from what we had here, out-of-box drivers, operating systems, applications, etc. If you look at the nodes, funnily enough, they tie up about the same. So, operating systems, out-of-box drivers, once you put something in over on this side here, it will show up in this set of folders. So I guess the first thing we need to do before we do anything else is to get the Windows 7 WIM image in here. Now, a couple of ways you can do this. You can create a custom one, sysprep it, make all your modifications, and then drag that in as a custom WIM. But we're going to just take the base WIM straight off of the Windows 7 media.
And that's supported now, is it? You can actually do that? Because I know in Windows Vista there was a bit of a screw-up, wasn't there?
The problems are still kind of there.
Okay.
It's actually, they tell you about it now,
right,
rather than
okay.
just making you faff around for a while.
So I guess the other thing to say while you're pootling on there, WIM's sort of like Microsoft's new image format. Well, it's not new, it's an image format. So if you haven't come across WIM, it's just like Ghost, isn't it, really?
It's a bit betterer. Betterer, absolutely.
Yeah. And it's not bit level, it does...
It's actual file level, so
yeah.
it can use single instance storage to try and bring down the size.
And the other thing I've seen you do quite successfully, which is surprising, is you can open up a WIM file afterwards, can't you, and modify... you know, files in there like sysprep inf.
You can, and you can also mount the registry files as well. So if you made a mistake or you need to do something in the registry, you can actually, once you've mounted the WIM file,
uh-huh.
you can go in there and you can then mount the registry and you can make the changes, close it all back up, and it saves you having to go through a two-day image rebuild process.
Which reminds me of safe boot.
Oh, don't even say that word. Okay, so we've gone in there to import the new operating system. Now, this gives you three different options. The full set of source files is pretty much what it says mm-hmm. on the tin. So you're going to be pulling everything off the Windows image. A custom image file is obviously just the image file that you've captured up. And then the bottom one, we're not going to be bothering with WDS images, so we'll skip over that for the time being. And we're actually going to import the WIM image itself, not the whole disk.
Gotcha.
So we're going to select the custom image file. I'm going to point this then.
Yeah, I was going to say, because the full files, that was for XP, wasn't it?
Yeah, it's if you wanted to do the unattended, the
yeah.
old school unattended files using $OEM dollars and those kind of things. So we'll find the install WIM. Be careful not to use the boot.wim, that's not going to get you very far. So pick the install WIM off of the Windows 7 media there. See next on that. Now, what we've got here is we've taken a custom WIM,
uh-huh.
but this custom WIM still needs some of the files that you have on the Windows 7
okay.
media itself. So this is where it wasn't really very well documented in Vista. If you don't do what I'm about to do now, it's all going to go horribly wrong and it will fail. So don't just randomly...
So you only get that screen when you're not importing a custom WIM. This is only really for importing
yeah.
from the CD.
This is from the CD itself.
Okay.
So if you sysprepped and captured your own custom WIM,
right.
you won't need to do this, but we have to, unfortunately. So you notice there's two different sections. So you've got the bottom one, which is if you're doing XP, you can have the sysprep files. We don't need that. We actually need the unattend files, which we'll get from the media again. So we point this to the Windows 7 media. Hit next. Hopefully this will tell us that it is Windows 7. Yeah, it would have given you an error message there if you pointed it to, I don't know, a torrent file or something like that.
Gotcha.
And it would have called you a spaz, probably. So in this case, we'll call it name of the folder, Windows 7, good as any. Hit next on there, and done. So what this is going to do, it's going to go and drag the WIM image off the machine, and also, if you see up here, all of the other files that it needs. And that's going to take some time, so obviously we'll try and speed this up or something.
Yeah, you're going to have fun doing that.
It's going to be good. We need to come up with some music to put over the top of it, though.
Well, it's got to be a children's TV program from yesteryear.
Now, I haven't seen what you've had before, so I don't know what...
Well, we've had Three Masked Hounds. Battle of the Planets, I don't know if we've had that.
Battle of the Planets. Have we had Danger Mouse?
No.
No Danger Mouse.
No Danger Mouse. Okay, Danger Mouse.
So guys, when this speeds up in just a few seconds, you'll be hearing the Danger Mouse theme tune, and hopefully that will, well, get you back to your youth, if you were ever watching Danger Mouse. If you weren't, it's obviously not going to help you much. And get you through this a lot less painfully than it's going to take me and Nicky.
Yep.
A Danger Mouse going over the top
there
of us.
Go.
So, as if by magic, the process has completed successfully, which obviously there was never any doubt. So we'll hit finish on that, and if we just go back to the share again, we'll just show you that it has actually done something. Click the right thing. So the operating system now has Win 7, which is what we told it to call it, and in here you have a whole bunch of things, specifically the install.wim and a bunch of other files that you need. Now there's one thing which is missing from this set of files, and that's a catalogue for Windows 7.
Okay.
So what's going to happen? We're going to edit what's called the unattend.xml. So this is the equivalent of the unattend.txt or a sysprep. Now to edit it, it's a much more graphical interface than you had before. So you're going to have components, and you drop components into the various stages through the installation process,
okay,
and then you modify things on there. Now it needs to know what type of WIM image it is. So it has to create a catalogue file. Now, to be honest, that's going to take quite some time, and
so
it's too
one
short.
So
we do have one.
Actually, when you found this out, didn't you waste an entire day finding this out?
I may have wasted an entire day finding this out.
Okay.
So I'm not going to waste a day of the viewer's time.
Because if you put all the episodes together, they've already done that, haven't they?
I'm saying nothing.
Oh, no. I've got to put effort into it.
Effort?
Yeah.
I don't want to get told off just because you don't put any effort in. I'm going into the wrong place now, so we're just going to do until I remember where things are.
I do that.
What, do?
No, just pretend that.
Just randomly click.
Yeah, you sort of accidentally get into wrong folding here.
Okay,
no,
yeah.
That looks all right.
Yeah, it just to show you what one which didn't have a catalogue file in would have looked like. So this is a catalogue file. You'll notice it's got a suffix CLG.
Okay, so this was created from...
This was created. So what will happen, when I press the edit unattend XML in a minute, if you didn't have a catalogue file, it will go and create one for you.
Okay.
But we're not going to do that. So we're going to copy this catalogue file straight into here. It's a quick little shortcut for you. So once you've created one catalogue file, you're good to go. So we'll do that. So that's now in there. So we'll close down this other one so don't get confused. It's bound to happen. So now we have our operating system. So potentially we could do something with this now. Install it probably would be a good...
Okay.
First start, but we don't want to do that just yet. There's a couple of other things we want to sort of tag onto it. First things first, I'll just show you what it says if you click on it. So this is basically what it is. So you can see this has opened up a WIM and it's kind of looking at the headers and saying these are what's in here. So there's one image. You can put multiple images in a WIM file, but we're not going to confuse everyone. And that's the size. It's Windows 7 Enterprise. Good to go. So that's now going to sit there and happily do nothing while we do the other bits and pieces. So, as Nicky rightly said, one of the things we can do now is we can inject drivers into this build. So, if you had a number of different machines, so say you had a couple of Dells, maybe 755s, 745s, a couple of HPs, 7800s, 7900s. They were all going to have different drivers. If you had an old ghost image, you'd have to end up having one build for each one, which not great. So what we'll do...
I used to do. Ghost on one machine.
Oh, that's terrible.
Pick up the drivers and put it on another machine. It never used to work properly, so fix it, take a ghost to that one, put it on another one. And that was for a training company, though, so they only used to have to last a week.
That's terrible. I can't condone that sort of thing. So what we'll do, we'll just import the drivers for all of those four different types of machines, and they'll get injected at build time. And the way this will work is when it boots into WinPE, which again we'll describe in a minute, it will do a plug-and-play bus scan for the machine, say, these are all my plug-and-play IDs.
Okay.
Have you got any drivers for me? It will send this up to the server. The server will check those plug-and-play IDs against the driver database and then send those down to the machine. The machine will store them in the right place, reference them in the install program, and then there you go. They'll turn up.
So whilst you do that, again, XP was a bit of a hassle for mass storage drivers, wasn't it?
Indeed.
In fact, it still continues to be. Windows 7, is that got easier? Or
It's still got the underlying problems, but you still have to use the AHCI drivers from Intel, and they have to be available. Now, the way we're doing this, because we're doing basically an unattended build followed up by applications, so we haven't sys-prepped it. So it's basically we're pushing down a new image every time. So we can just inject those mass storage device drivers at this stage. Mm-hmm. If we take in a sys-prep, it gets a little bit trickier. But we can get around it. Well, I don't think we're going to have time to go into the ins and outs of getting
Well, if we like this, we can do another one that goes further.
Absolutely. But we'll get it basically working, because that's going to be a big enough challenge as it is, with no Windows key or right-click button. Okay, so the drivers now. So we go, again, on the left-hand side to the out-of-box drivers tab. Right-click.
Look at that.
The gas now. So we're going to import the drivers. Now, what this is relying on is that you've already found all the drivers that you need. Now, you can do this in a couple of ways. Obviously, you can go to the manufacturer's website and you can download the drivers specific for a particular model. Another way of doing it is, obviously, if you've got a ready-built machine coming from the manufacturer, you can use something called Driver Max. Mm-hmm. So you may have to Google it, or we can flash up some subtitles down here or something.
You're giving yourself work, mate.
Google it. We'll cut that last one out. Google Driver Max, and you can run that on a ready-built machine and export all of the drivers into a nice folder structure, which you can then import.
I've saved so much time with that tool.
It makes life, and it picks up all the little ones. So you have, like, the at the end when you
bus drivers and
bus drivers and bus power managements. They're a pain, really. So really good tool, Driver Max. We've already got quite a load of drivers on here anyway, so we're going to point it to a driver directory. Coming in drivers, we'll say T61 for goodness sake. Actually, do you want that, because they're all 64-bit drivers, they're not going to work so well. Windows 7 down, that'll do. So we're pointed towards this folder. Underneath that folder, you're obviously going to have a load of drivers. You hit next, it'll go off and it'll enumerate all of those drivers, which is a little bit too quick for me, so I'm thinking maybe there wasn't actually anything in that
one
I pointed it to.
The wrong folder, perhaps.
Shall we try that again?
I think so.
People won't notice.
No, they won't.
Cool.
Okay. Oh, no, effort.
Effort. Come on, Nicky, come on. You can do better. It's not your school report card here. Okay, so we'll try another one. Drivers, SX280. Now, I know they're in there. So we've got a display driver and a media driver. So media is going to be the audio. So if we hit next in there, actually doing something. Fantastic. So it's going and pulling out those drivers. And it's, can you guess where they're going to put them? It's a tricky one for you.
In a directory called out-of-box drivers.
Wow.
There you go. Was paying attention sometimes.
Okay, so this is now completed, imported them in. So now if we look in, as Nicky rightly said, the out-of-box drivers, display and media, and then these will be available to the build when it comes to that stage.
So, I mean, that's the one amazing thing about MDT, I think, is the fact that lots of people don't realise that it can do this. So this is a free tool, and out of the box, you're already better than, well, maybe not better than Ghost, well, for me anyway. Okay. can you give us half an hour for filming? That's the problems of doing at work, eh?
Well, at least it shows that we're still at work and quite late on in the day.
Absolutely.
We could offer to hoover up afterwards.
Nah.
You. You're obviously much more domesticated now that you have a nice
hoovering anyway.
No, that's what I mean. We could say that Wilhelm is obviously already hoovered. We don't have to hoover.
Okay, let's go for that.
Cool. Okay, this is freaking me out, this Mac. But yeah, so I mean, this is straight out of the box. We haven't had to do any clever configuration, and the drivers can come down. And you can have this for as many different model types as you need. So you can have 100 different models, just have quite a big folder structure.
Uh-huh.
But bear in mind that some models obviously have the same drivers in each. So you won't have to install you won't have to import the same driver three times, three different models, because it'll do a plug and play bus ID check, and it'll say, right, okay, that's the driver you need. So now we've got an operating system, we've got some drivers. I guess we might as well do an application as well.
Might as well.
What would you recommend? What would you like to see on this image, Nicky?
Office. I was going to be awkward, but
you're going to say,
nothing sprung to mind.
Okay, so same again, left-hand side, we're into applications new. Now, obviously, we're going to have source files included into this, so application with source files is selected. The name of this, I'm going to call it Microsoft Office. Might as well use 2007. Now, again, the source directory obviously needs to know where the files are, so we'll go and do that now. So, if we go to application source, hopefully we should see...
There'll be a time where you'll be able to import a torrent, I reckon.
You reckon?
I don't know.
Do you think that's a good thing to be doing?
Well, no, it is a good way to actually share files.
Share files? Yeah. What sort of files would you share on a torrent?
Well, get this way, I was downloading at 1.7 megabytes a second the other day, and he's thinking, well, it'd be nice to download ISO, mind you, I suppose I do, from Microsoft's site.
Yeah. I mean, Microsoft's one of the few places which you can get the maximum bandwidth anyway, isn't it? Sorry, so I've just jumped along here, so luckily, Nicky picked a good one, so the command line for Office is setup.exe, because we've already got a custom MSP file included anyway, so that's in there. Now, what I should point out at this stage, if you wanted to do an MSI as the command line, you can't just put MSI, so whatever it is. So
I noticed you do that on your SMS, on your SCCM packages still, don't you?
So, I mean, that's just because I'm trying to tie the two together.
Okay.
So no other reason, but... Basically, MDT is too stupid to work out that MSI is going to have to reference msiexec.exe. So if this was going to be a...
I suppose it's running Windows. Oh, no, it's not running WinP at this time, is it? It's actually running Windows
7. This is the actual operating system. It's just not clever enough. Yeah. That's its biggest problem. So you'd have to type in msiexec.exe space /i and then, obviously, the rest of the command line. Mm-hmm. If you don't do that, it will fail. You'll scratch your head thinking... Why is that not working? Because you'll run the MSI in Windows and it'll work, because it's obviously clever enough. But once again, Nicky's very kindly picked Office, so setup.exe it is. So again, next. This will then go off, it will pull all of the source files for Office, and it will dump those again. Where would it put those, Nicky?
I'm guessing in the deployment share in a directory called Applications.
Oh, but what would it do after that?
Probably a subfolder called Office.
Wow. Shall we see? Shall we wait and see, viewers? See if Nicky's right.
Is there an exam for this, MDT?
There is. It's an exam with 75 questions. And
then you passed it, yeah?
I passed that.
What, 2010?
2010. No, actually, that's 2008. But
crap, man.
Yeah, it's not...
When's 2010 out?
I'm going to
beat it to something.
Honestly, the 2008 exam, though, is 75 questions, and they put me down for 3.5 hour slot. I sat there, I couldn't believe it was 75 questions. It's...
That's too much, isn't it? I'm just about handle 45.
I mean, the Windows 7 one was only, I think, 45 questions, and that was a new technology. This was... You thought they'd have pruned down the number of questions.
Was it a pre-release one, a beta or something?
Well, no, you'd think, again, with 2008, it would have been out, but...
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I didn't get my chartered certificate member for that one. Although I did for Windows 7. You haven't yet, though, have you?
Not for Windows 7. I have no interest in Windows 7.
But you said you did get a chartered...
I got for Windows 2000. I've got a plaque, mate. I'll bring it in.
I've got a plaque that's old school. But for anyone who's out there and watching, if you pass a Microsoft exam within 6 months of it being released... 6 months, I believe?
Is it 6 months? I don't know. I got a chartered member because I was, I think, one of the first 200.
Oh, okay. Well, I think now they may...
They probably relaxed it. That's probably why you fell into it.
I'm going to give you that one. Okay. Obviously, I was too young to do it when you did yours. But yeah, if you pass it within the first 6 months, they give you a chartered member MCP, so just the certificate looks slightly different. Nothing different. Okay, so applications installed. So, Nicky, you said it would be installed and copied to...
I was guessing the deployment share in the directory called Applications. There you go.
I think that's about right. You did say Office. Obviously, we called it Microsoft Office 2007. You weren't paying attention.
Well, I can't see that from there.
Okay, we'll let you off that. So now we have an application. We have
and presumably here you can put all your line of business applications in here, Shockwave and...
Absolutely, and when we come to the task sequence, we'll see there's some clever sort of processing that you can do as well. So you can either, we'll see when we get there, but you can push all of your apps down, or you can push all of your apps down, but if it's a particular model and you need to have some sort of Dell-specific software installed, you can do that. So you say, is model equals... Dell Latitude E6400. If so, then install. Do is desktop, is laptop. So you can do quite a lot of processing as well to try and get it up and running. But yeah, so we've got an application. We won't bore everyone with putting whole line of business apps in. We have an operating system. We have some drivers.
Cool.
Now, another thing that we can do is we can put packages in. So this is where Windows Vista and 7 really excel over XP. Mm. So with XP, if you needed to patch it, you'd have to wait until the XP image came down, you then have to wait for WSUS to pick up and then drop the patches down. Mm. Now with Vista and Windows 7, you can push these down at build time. So in here, as a for example, one of the patches that you need to send down if you wanted to use the Windows XP compatibility mode, for example, that's actually a patch.
Okay.
So it's a patch which you need to get from Microsoft. Now, luckily, we've already downloaded this, and we'll put this in here as well, so you can see that that comes down. So, in the packages, right-click, insert import OS packages. Now, you see up here, they're .msu. Now, this is the new patch. So you've got cabs or MSUs. MSUs are what's coming up.
I reckon it's Microsoft Update.
What do you reckon?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. You could be right. So, we'll find the package. And hit next. And it's importing it in.
I must admit, when we were doing BDD and stuff, you saw the updates thing. What's that for? Because, I mean, we work for an organisation which it specialises in OS deployment, doesn't it?
Pretty much,
well. And I think we're pretty damn good at it. But we didn't really do much Vista, did we, for whatever reason?
I think we've done... How long has Vista been out for? Two and a half years?
Yeah.
Maybe three. I think we've done two Vista deployments, so...
Yeah, got Project...
Nice one, Microsoft.
Yeah, Project kicking off a couple of weeks for XP rollout.
XP rollout,
that's
yeah.
That's all we're doing.
Yeah, SP3, everyone wants SP3. Okay, so we've got that package, and again, you can keep updating this, so you can just throw the packages in. Obviously, this isn't quite the same. You've also got the ability with the WIM files to open up the WIM and offline services, so you can push the apps in.
Can you do it by mounting the WIM?
Yeah, there's a couple of command lines, but again... Okay. If people are interested, we can go into another one to do that. But we'll do that package to start with. So now we've got all the things that we want to do stuff with. So we've got the OS, we've got the drivers, we've got the package that we want to install, we've got the applications that we need to install. We just need to tie all of this together and get it to actually do something. So what we'll use is a task sequence.
Okay.
Pretty much does what it says on the tin here. It's a sequential series of tasks that it will run one after the other. Try to keep things simple. So to do this, you have a new task sequence. You give it an ID, it can be anything you want. Bear in mind, you can't change the task sequence ID.
Can it be Nikki?
Do you want the ID or the name to be Nikki?
No, I want the ID to be Nikki. You said it could be anything I want. Because I think it can only be three characters, personally.
Nikki is a spaz. Okay, so now the task sequence ID, which you can't change, is called Nikki, so it will permanently be called Nikki no matter what you want to do.
Okay, not bad.
And the task sequence name we could change if we decided that Isa Paz is not deemed a suitable name. So we'll go next with that one. Now in this case we're going to be doing, it's a standard client task sequence that we're installing. We're installing a standard image pretty much, we're not doing anything.
So if you want to use this to replace from Ghost, that's all you need to do. Is it worth looking at the others? Because I'm...
Okay, so what you can do, you can use this as a replacement task sequence. And the way that will run is it will do something called user state migration on one machine.
Uh-huh.
And then when you run it again, it will do user state.
Cool.
It will install and then do user state migration on the next one. OS post installation task sequence. This is, you can group a whole load of applications together and then you can put this down after the OS has been installed. Server, obviously. Light touch OEM task sequence. Now, a lot of you out there, if you have to deal with your sort of your purchasing of machines, you may ask HP, Dell, Fujitsu, I don't know how many we have to mention to not be vendor specific. to get your custom image pre-built, pre-loaded onto your hard disk. You can do the same kind of thing with MDT. So you can take all of the installation files, which would normally be sitting up on this server, and you can pre-mount those in a special partition on the disk. You can then, funnily enough, ghost the disk and give that to your vendor, and all of your machines will come in with this pre-installed. As soon as they start up, it will kick off the installation. You don't have to worry about media or proxy booting. Now, you may think it's not really a brilliant thing to be doing, but it is lightning fast, so it'll speed everything up because it's pulling it straight off of its local disk.
I mean, do people ever, because I was thinking about that, and the trouble you get with putting the image on the hard disk is it's going to age, isn't it?
It potentially will.
And lots of people buy machines and they stick it in a cupboard for, you know, 4 months or so. So could you actually just put the boot image on that? Would that be helpful?
Do people actually do that?
Have you ever done that?
They don't, because the people we've asked, they specifically wanted it preloaded, because basically they'd already paid the money to have something loaded, so they wanted something sensible on there. So they wanted to make it look like they were doing something. So that's why it comes in. So we're going to do the standard client task sequence. Hit next on there. Now, gives us the option of what operating systems you want to install. Now, we've only got one, so we'll pick that one. Now, this is where it gets slightly complicated with specifically Vista or Windows 7. Product keys are notoriously complex, so we're not going to specify one here. Mm-hmm. I don't know how we're going to do this without showing our key that we're going to be using.
We can just do install. Just do next, install that key or something.
Yeah. So we'll, just so you're aware, we would normally put a key in here, but for obvious legal reasons, we're not going to put anything that we happen to have.
Because we don't own them legally,
is that? No, they belong to somebody else, but somebody owns them legally. So in this case, we need to have who's going to be the user of this machine. So it's going to show up when you look at the properties of the machine, user, company. So obviously we're IT idiots. Not that we're a company or anything. Not registered for VAT, Inland Revenue, don't come after us.
Actually, if we register for VAT, at least we can claim stuff back because we don't make any money, so wouldn't that be a good thing?
What would you claim back though?
Laptops.
Just randomly buy laptops.
And sell on eBay. that's an income, isn't it?
I was going to say, that takes us into a slightly different legal issue. So if we do itidiots.com.
Yep.
Com.
C-O-M.
Thank you for helping me with my spelling there, Nicky. So, this is a strange one. I have to say here, you have to put something here. They've now allowed you to put blank in, which is better than 2008. Before, you had to put something in there, or it would not let you get past this screen. It used to drive me mad. Okay, so again, I'm not going to specify an admin password at this time. I'm going to do this when we create the unattended XML. And then hit next. So this has gone and done the task sequence. Now, this is a question for you, Nicky.
Oh, dear.
Where do you think that task sequence has just been saved?
I'm going to say distribution share task sequences.
Control,
isn't it?
So you do actually pay attention and use this in some time. So, yes, in control, we have the task sequence, which is called Nicky, for obviously stupid reasons. And that's sitting in there. So that's now been created. So we've gone through the process, but it doesn't really tell you anything about what's happened. So if we come into here, we'll show you what the task sequence actually looks like. So if we look at the properties of that task sequence.
I've got to admit, because I've taken it up to the task sequence, and this is where I think, well, sort of, you can do that there.
Excellent. Thanks for that, Nicky. So this is the task sequence. So you'll notice there's various stages, which are defined by folders, pretty much. And if you look in here, you can put some logic processing in here to say if XYZ, then do blah, blah, blah. I want to do something slightly more useful than blah, blah, blah. But if you wanted to blah, 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 it'd be perfect. So if we open some of these out so you can see
how it's working. XYZ.
We might put one of those in and see if it works. So first of all, it has to initialize. And this is really an internal process. It's going to do its own... it's basically its own checklist to make sure that it can run.
Okay.
Then it'll validate, make sure that you've got the processor. Now, this is an interesting one because Windows 7 technically requires a 1 gig processor and 1 gig of RAM, but we're not going to put that in there.
See, old, what do you reckon to it running on a gig notebook?
It does work.
It does work. It's not desirable though. I wouldn't go over the board say, oh, this is brilliant.
No, it's something that is very much, if you had a netbook and you wanted to run Windows 7, yeah, go ahead. The biggest problem with the netbooks is the processors, obviously.
Yeah.
The RAM isn't an issue. The 1 gig of RAM, not a problem.
Okay.
The fact is, if you look at the processor, because it's an Atom, pretty much, yeah, isn't it? And it's a single core. And it's a single core which is going to kill you on Windows 7. It does need to have a bit of processing power. For example, I did rebuild one machine, and it was a P4 with hyper-threading. I forgot to turn the hyper-threading on. Ran like a dog. Turn the hyper-threading back on. Everyone's happy again. Okay. So that's my one tip for you. It's all about the cores, not the bands.
Not the bands.
So yeah, so it goes to the validation. We're not doing the state capture because we're leaving that for the day. Then it comes into the pre-install. Now the pre-install will basically configure the driver injection. Now this will.
So what I get, I'm going to interrupt here. So what I get confused here is. What in here tells me...
I'm just going to move the cursor to where you're
pointing. Capture, what tells me that it's not going to run that bit?
What tells you?
Yeah, is it just an end options disabled?
Well, now the first thing about this...
Because to me all task sequences look the same.
Absolutely, and the simple thing is, we're not running this in Windows. Okay. If we ran this in Windows, it would ask us to do a state capture. So if we had a machine sitting there, which had XP on there, we put this CD, DVD in and ran it. It would go through this task sequence, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and go down. Now, because it's running in, when we do it, we're going to be running it straight into WinPE.
Right.
It's going to come straight in at pre-install. And then at the end, when it has state restore, it will know that there's no state to restore, and therefore it will just skip past it. So I just did the same thing. I was pointing at the screen, and obviously nobody could see it because the camera's over there. I'll learn. So, yeah, so...
You'll mirror that.
We've got the photo and the picture there. I mean, we can't get rid of that.
Well, put the mirror there and put the photo on the other side. That would work.
Good thinking. So yeah, so it starts at pre-install and it comes straight into the new computer. So first thing it does, partitions the disk. You can put multiple partitions in if you want. If you do that, then you have to do a little bit of thinking around here. So you have to decide which is the first partition that you're creating, and then you have to give that a specific size, and then the next one can be a percentage or vice versa. We're just going to have a single disk, because basically life's too short. So we'll come through there, it will inject the drivers, so we'll get those ready for the OS. Then it will obviously install the operating system, that's the one that we told it. Then it will come back here and inject the drivers into the new Windows 7. So the first driver injection was making sure that things like the mass storage device driver was ready for it immediately, and then this one will come in and do the main drivers. Once it's installed, reboot, go through the mini setup wizard as in any other installation. Boot itself up into Windows, auto log on as the local administrator, finish off the tasks sitting under state restore, and then at the end it will give you a nice screen saying, yep, well done, you're finished.
Okay, applications.
Applications. So at the moment, there's a couple of things we want to do here just to keep things tidy. Now, I don't really want to do this capture image stage. I don't even want it to think about it. So I'm going to disable this by highlighting the top level, capture image, going to options, and disabling that step. And hitting apply when it gets there. And I'm going to do the same with the restore user state, because I don't want to do that. But you've seen here we've got the task sequence variables. We can do quite a lot of cool stuff. And again, if people want to see things like that, we can go through and we can do some clever things at a later date. We don't want to capture the image there either. So,
the capturing image thing, am I right in saying, because at the moment when we deploy this, we're going to get Windows 7 deployed, then that update, then the driver injection, and then the application. So the capture is for capturing all of that afterwards, and then using that as a deployment.
Yeah, so if we'd gone through this and this was going to be creating our reference machine, by the way guys, I think we're going to have to change the tape.
Okay. Is it flashing or running out?
It's flashing, so I don't know quite when that finished.
Dave?
You take, we're using quite old technology here. I think we should explain. We've got a video camera which actually has real life tape.
It's got tapes on it as well, isn't it?
Big tape. So that's why we've just had to obviously do the disappearing act. But we're back now. Unless, of course, I've edited that out. And
yeah,
then all of this is just us talking rubbish to carry on. So, what were we talking about?
We're talking about state capture and capturing a full machine. So you've rolled that machine with the application office and we've captured that back up again.
Yeah. So that's what we're doing now, we're just deploying our image. We'd be joining it to the right domain, mm-hmm. and this would be our deployment tool. Now, what you can also use this for is to create the reference machine, which you'd do all of this, as Nicky rightly said, and you'd put all your line of business applications in there. You then sysprep that automatically, you'll reboot back into WinPE, capture that WIM image back up to the server, and then you can use that to deploy down.
And have you done that in Windows 7?
We have.
And it all works fine?
It all works fine.
Cool.
So, I mean, the difference there is whether it's a lean image or a fat image. So there's two distinctly different ways of doing images, and they both have their merits. Obviously, a lean image is much easier to manage, but takes longer to deploy.
Yeah, the deployments, because you're going to have to do the patches and office deployment, then the service pack.
And then all of the additional apps on top. So, office is the killer. Yeah. So, some people, if they need high-speed deployments, then you sometimes do a fatter image, put some of the apps in there, and then it's basically easier to deploy.
And I like MDT because the disadvantage of you having a fat image always was that it ages. Yep. But this is a mechanism that allows you to easily recreate that, doesn't it?
Absolutely, because you just kick off the task sequence and it'll do everything that you've just done, mm-hmm. pause at the right time so you can make any of the modifications to, say, the look and the feel, press the script again, and it goes off. And absolutely, you've got an image which you can do over and over again to give it the same look and feel. So, as you rightly said, Nick, we need to put the app in here. So at the moment, we've told it what operating system it's going to be using, but it doesn't know that it has to install Office. So we've got the install applications here. So this is in the state restore, guys. So just to recap, this is when it's already booted back into Windows 7, auto-logged in as the local administrator, and then it's running through here.
That confuses me, the nameless of it. What applications under state restore? I know that's when it takes place, but it's such a major part of the deployment.
It is. It's basic. That's come from BDD 2.5, and they just brought the terminology all the way through. It doesn't really make sense because the state restore is only one tiny part of what they class as state restore. But in here, we will select a single application. If we browse here, magically we get Office 2007 available to us. Okay, just tell it what it's doing so it gives it something sensible. Install Office. Hit apply. And done. So basically, that is now a task sequence which will pick up the Windows 7 WIM image, and it will deploy the Windows 7 WIM image, inject the drivers if it needs it, and then install the operating system afterwards.
Cool.
But there's always a but. Now that we've done the task sequence...
You said but.
Okay, so also I picked a 64-bit.
Oh, did you?
So we'll just gloss past that and I'm sure it'll still work. Hyper-V is 64-bit.
It is 64, yeah.
Excellent. So now we have to edit the XML. So this is where I said when we put the catalog file back in earlier. Now, if I hit on edit on here now, we'll come back up. And this is the answer file creation tool. Now, the only problem I do have is that I've noticed that it's 64-bit just before I press the button. So I'm going to cancel out of here. I'm going to quickly dive into the operating system. If you want to distract people while this is happening so they don't realize what's
happening. I'm just going to leave you in the limelight, mate.
You're very kind.
That's all right.
So we'll delete out the 32-bit OS.
Are we going to have to re-import that WIM file again?
No, the WIM file's fine, because the WIM file's a 64-bit.
Oh, okay.
So all we need is the catalog file. Now, luckily, we also have a 64-bit catalog file available to us.
It's almost like you've deployed this from this system before.
You'd think that, wouldn't you? But it's absolutely had no other...
It's not a production system.
No, definitely. I mean, a production system would be ethically wrong.
It would be.
So if we go to the 64-bit one, and look, there's a catalog file there. So we'll take that one. We will drop that back where we were. Into ITI, operating systems, Windows 7, drop it into there. And then we'll go back as if none of that nastiness has happened.
Well, so you can make that happen. Or unhappen it.
From what we've said, it's really a case of we leave the mistakes in to prove that it's a real life.
No, I think that's what differentiates us. we don't get it right first time.
Sometimes second time either. No. But this time you'll notice down here we now have 64-bit catalog, yep. So that's fine. So this is now the equivalent of what the Honor 10 TXT would have done. So if anyone's out there and has done Honor 10 TXTs in the past, you'll notice this may be slightly easier because it's graphical and you don't have to remember the syntax. Or so you'd think. So in here, we have a couple of different sections that Windows 7 wants to import our sort of custom data into. First things first, Windows PE, we need to make sure that Windows PE is in the right language and we can, not that we have to, but if we want to type anything, we type it with a British keyboard.
Yeah, that could be problematic.
But we'll survive. At least it's kind of got English characters on it. But we'll go through the process. So by default, obviously, because everyone who buys a Windows operating system lives in America, everything's set up to be American types. Now you notice again, there's already a slight sort of mismatch between what maybe the locales are. So we've got a couple, we've got ENUS, and we've got 049, blah, 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 blah. Why can't they just do the same thing? Why can't it be the same all the way down? That's my question. But it isn't, so this is what we have to work with. So, rather sadly, I know all of this by heart. English keyboard is 809 rather than 409. This is where it gets a little bit tricky, because when Vista first came out, it never told you what the values for these regional settings were, but for anyone who's out there, English is ENGB. Setup UI again, ENGB. Come down into here, we don't really need to worry about too much in here. We'll take the display out, because if we've got a widescreen machine, it automatically, if you have this in, tries to default it to a 4x3 and it gets a little bit weird. So for this one, we will delete that section. Checks, etc., etc. Now the image install, try not to delete this, this is quite important. It's telling what image it's going to be installing. User data, again, accept the EULA. We'll put some stuff in here. Now this stuff you don't actually need to put in, I'm just putting it in because I like typing. I find it quite soothing.
You had an incredibly loud keyboard today though, didn't you?
Yeah, I thought Sue was actually going to kill me at one stage. I just put my headphones in and pretended it wasn't happening. She's just going to do a bad murder. Okay, so the WinPE, there's not really a lot you have to do on that because it is pretty much just setting up the WinPE environment and nothing much happens. Where all of the magic, as it were, happens is in the specialise section. Now, this is, well, I say that, in the specialise and in the UBI, which is a brilliant name for something. For anyone who doesn't know, it's out of box experience.
Okay.
OOBE or UBI.
I'm probably excited then.
UBI. I'm not even bringing that conversation any further. So some of the options we have here, you can set these up or you can not. Some of them you do need to put in, some of them you don't. For example here, the homepage, IT Idiots, that very kindly set that up for us when we went through the process just now. And you can go through with Windows 8, obviously. When it starts up, you've got that really annoying...
Windows 8?
Internet Explorer 8, obviously.
Yeah, when you start Internet Explorer 8, you've got this really annoying what, sorry?
We're going to start again. Right. So yeah, so when you open up Internet Explorer 8, you've got that the start wizard when you have to go through and you have to say, do I want to use Bingle as my search engine and set up all of the accelerators? Yeah. Now, you can set all of that up here and then disable the first run wizard, should you wish. I'm going to disable the first run wizard just because I can. But you can modify this as much or as little as you actually want to. International Core, again, we have to go through all of this one more time, and we'll be doing it a third time shortly. So again, 809s and GBs. It's just really to reinforce what you need to do. GB. Also, if we scroll down some of these, you'll notice that they have some drop-down lists. We don't have to worry about those. Shell setup. Now again, we don't want to be in Pacific Standard Time, and this is another Microsoft-ism. So, for example, Nikki, what is the GMT time zone?
Zero.
Okay, that's one way of doing it. If you're on a computer, what would you select for?
Well, I think I know this one, because it says Edinburgh, doesn't it? Isn't it?
No, I mean, what you have, for anyone who's out there and using computers, as opposed to Nikki, who just kind of pretends he does,
what?
The time zone for GMT would be 085. By default, if in the good old days, in the good old days, GMT time zone would be 085. If you had a sysprep.inf file, time zone 085. they decided not to do that now. So now, you now have to know exactly what it is. So I know this without having to look at any notes at all. And it's GMT standard time.
Whenever I was teaching Aslan, every time I said GMT, I couldn't help but say GMTB. And it's really embarrassing, you know. It doesn't...
So what's the time zone again?
GMT standard time.
GMTB standard time. Okay, and then in here, trying to get some sort of technical aspect into this podcast. Start panel off, show Windows Live, false. Basically just turning off all of the first wizards. Product key, we would obviously type something in here, but we're not going to. Disable auto, daylight saver time. Why would you want to do that? I don't know. And do you want the Bluetooth? Some of the things you can turn on and off are ridiculous. So do you want to show the Bluetooth task panel icon? Does it really matter?
I think that's from feedback. I reckon they've added some of these in through.
They're just randomly putting stuff in. So we do that.
Because I've actually wanted to do that on XP though.
Really?
Yeah.
You can't do it on XP.
I know.
Upgrade to Windows 7.
Exactly. I know.
I've got this really good tool that you can use to help you out with that. Okay, so we'll go through all of those. There's a couple of other things that we should really do. And I'm going to have a little bit of trial and error here, because again, I can't remember off the top of my head which one it is. It's SPP. Licensing. Basically, we want to turn off the auto licensing tool, otherwise it would try and get on every time. As soon as you log on, it will immediately try and get off to Microsoft. Obviously, you'd want to activate and authorize immediately. There's no reason why you would never want to do that. So there is an option. I can't remember which one it is. Skip auto activation.
Well, certainly when you're trialing NDT, I mean, it's legitimate, isn't it? You don't want it. Absolutely. You don't want it licensing. You want to make sure it all works first.
So in this one, we'll skip the auto activation. So what I've done, I found the security license in CLC UX neutral, because that's obviously where it would be. I've dropped that into the specialized area, and I've basically enabled the skipping of the auto activation. So we'll let that one go through. You can do, again, down the left-hand side, these are all sections that you can drop into the various processes. If there's something which won't fit on a particular process, so it won't run, it won't let you. So some of these, it won't actually let you do it. So, again, we can go into a lot more detail if anyone out there is still watching and awake. But we'll go back to the UBI system. We'll do for the final time the 809 and the 809. And the GB, and the GB. Doesn't get soul destroying or anything after you've done this a few times. And then auto login. This is where the MDT script has done this for you. So it's automatically set up that the administrator is going to auto log on. It's going to do it 999 times. It's not really, don't worry. By the time it gets to the end of the script, it tidies itself up, it deletes that registry key, and you've got a normal machine which will run after it. Again, display, we don't want to force the display screen into a particular size, so we'll delete that one out. First run commands, again, once it's logged in as the administrator, the first thing it needs to do is sort of rerun its script to kick it off and then to do all of the application installation, etc., etc., and that's set up here in the first commands.
Okay.
Guys, that's pretty much it. So that is the modified unattend XML, so we'll save that, close that one down, and this is basically ready to go. So what we need to do, we need to create the boot image, which will be used on the WDS server to boot from here. So we'll close down one of these scary windows which keep opening up on me. And what we can also do up on the deployment share, just to try and confuse people, we've already set some variables in the task sequence, some in the image itself, and we can also do it in this section here. So the task sequence picks up all of these different things, all of these different components, and then basically runs through with them and pulls the data from whichever one it needs. Now what I'm going to do, it's again, here's one I prepared earlier, notes. So we'll go through what these are actually doing in a second. Lost the window, Nicky.
Got it?
Yeah. So I'll paste all of these in here. pardon me. So all of these ones which say skip, these are all deployment wizard windows which would show up normally if you go through the system. So we're skipping the applications because we've only got one and we've automatically selected
it. You've sort of hard-coded it as such.
The admin password, because we put that down here. Skip the locale selection because we've already told it's going to be UK. Skip the user data, skip the welcome screen. We're going to skip the capture as well. Skip the time zones, etc., etc. The SMS TS org name, IT Idiots, that's just a small technicality. When it shows up, if you don't type that in, it will show up as IT organization is installed in your operating system. This is just customizing which IT organization it happens to be. So we do that, and also the bootstrap. So this is the file which is used immediately that Windows PE starts up. Now what we want to do is tell it that it's going to skip the welcome screen and use a UK keyboard. Mm-hmm. Again, it's not going to help me too much, but that's what we'll do. So the bootstrap is for when the WinPE starts up, and the rules are for when it's actually going through the tile sequence itself. So we'll go close through there. We want to make this so it's only 64-bit, otherwise it will take twice as long to do what we're about to. Now we're going to get a sample background as well to put in WinPE. I mean, the standard one gets a little bit boring, so I have already created one of these as well, and that is sitting in the temp ITI. So we'll click that. So when WinPE builds it, I'll have this custom app in there. And that's it. Basically, it'll say any drivers, so any network drivers, any mass storage device drivers, when we do what we're about to do, which is update the deployment point, it will incorporate those network drivers, any patches, any mass storage device drivers in the WinPE image itself. So obviously,
that's kind of important because you boot up WinPE, don't you?
So as you're rightly about to say, WinPE, if it's not got all of the drivers, it's not going to work and you're not going to get onto the next stage, which I think you've had a few issues with in the past.
Yep.
Okay, so that's it. So we'll close all of these down. We'll then update that deployment point, ready to go. So we update the deployment share, optimize that, hit next. Okay, so what this is now going to go off and do is create us our boot images. Now, can you think where the boot images might get created to?
Deployment share boot.
Do you reckon deployment share boot? I think you might be onto a winner on that one, Nicky. Deployment share boot.
It's like a Microsoft exam, isn't it?
Just without the certificate at the end. So, that wasn't what I was expecting it to do. I was expecting F5 to refresh the page.
Ah.
That's not happening. Doesn't matter. I'll right click, that's much easier. Refresh. So, this is the boot image that it's going to be creating down here. But I can't deal with these Apple things, man.
You can swap them around, I think. So, I think it's functioning in F5.
Okay. Well, while that's going, again, we may need to speed this up. Could get a little bit boring, but we'll just have a quick wait and see. So what this is going to do is going to expand the WIM image for the boot file. It's going to put in the new backdrop, and then it's going to carry on.
This is the PE WIM image.
This is the WIM PE. So this is what will be booted up from WDS, and this will, when it boots up from WIM PE, it'll come back up to the server and use the deployment share to do the rest of it. Let's just have a look to see how much processor.
So this just creates an ISO, doesn't it?
It creates the WIM file and the ISO.
Okay.
So if you wanted to boot this from a CD or put it onto a bootable USB stick, you could burn the ISO onto it, or you can just use the WIM image, which we're going to do, and just locate that onto the WDS server.
Okay.
Which unfortunately is, again, already built, so we can't really show you the implementation of WDS. Just have to take our word for it.
It's quite straightforward, though, isn't it?
It is.
Because I've installed it once and imported a WIM image to it, and it just...
I think you actually installed this one that we're using, which has no...
Installed well.
No, it works perfectly, so that's why I thought it might have been mine, but looking at it, it could have been yours.
It's tidy, is it?
It's tidier than if it was mine, yeah. But you're getting really hungry now.
I'm so starving. I should have eaten.
For anyone who's watching, it's now 8 o'clock at night.
Is it really 8?
It's 8 o'clock at night.
Jesus.
And I think Subway's in order.
I've got to encode this afterwards.
You've got to encode it. How am I going to get this, by the way?
Well, I think what we'd do is, because it could take, it's quite a long capture, isn't it? It's going to be about an hour. So I've got to capture that. It's going to take about 40 minutes, so I'll do it at home and upload it to our FTP site, because that'll probably come in about 300-400 meg. It's either that or we sit here another hour, which I'm not prepared to do.
No. Dear God, an entire day at work, and then...
Yeah, I'll start on it tomorrow.
Doesn't bear thinking about. It's fun, isn't it?
Hey.
Have you watched Inbetweeners yet?
No, but I was aware of it, and I noticed it. It's on after IT Crowd, isn't it?
It is.
But I thought I won't delve into it in the middle. I'll get this.
I can loan you series 2.
Okay. That sounds cool. Well, normally that stuff in series 1.
No, you haven't missed anything. Apart from the whole of series 1.
Okay.
I've run out of idle chit-chat to do over this, so I think this is a speed up.
Yeah.
Possibly Banana Man.
I'm just trying to think if we're going to start Windows 7 off.
That's another good point, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
They take a remarkably long amount of time, don't they?
Yeah.
Do they always take this long?
No, it's just because it's the nature of what you're doing. If you look at a lot of our episodes, we don't... There are some speed-up ones in there.
Cool. We'll rush through this next bit and get it kicked off.
Excellent. So the other thing might be worth having a look at ZD screen capture.
We can do it on the server, can't we?
Yeah, on the server, and also it's real time. There's no rendering afterwards.
Oh, okay.
Because this thing renders afterwards, but if you want to, you'll get a perfect screen capture out of it, full 20. But I'm going to just code it to web high quality.
Okay, what we'll do, because this is now, it's done the WIMP.
Okay.
So I'm happy with that. It's still going to go and create the ISO, as we said earlier, the ISO that you wanted to burn the CD. So just in the interest of time, really, and... So we don't want to spend any more time together than we really have to.
No.
Damn it, it's all worked anyway. So
it all worked.
It's all worked. So we now have a WIM image sitting in here.
Uh-huh.
Come up.
And the WDS server's on this as well, is it?
WDS server is here as well. So we'll open up WDS control panel. Servers. Now, two different types of images you can put on WDS. An install image. And a boot image.
Mm-hmm.
So, this is a boot image that we're putting on here. So, obviously, you go to boot image, you add boot image, you give it the file location, which, as we've already said, as Nikki rightly pointed out, is deployment share boot. Next, ITI, do not use, just in case anyone who's. Someone wherever they might be might want to use this. So again, do that, next. So now it's adding the boot image. So it's going to actually expand the WIM image.
I just thought hitting F12 could be fun.
You haven't really thought this all the way through to the end, have you?
I think it's function F12. I think function.
I'm going to go in a second.
Yeah.
Because we do need to get onto a different server now as well, don't we?
Ah.
So we can do that from here.
You can literally just ignore it.
Oh. Excellent. Okay, so Nikki's done some magic there.
Just think you can full screen that, I suppose.
Okay, so I guess what we should explain is we're now running this test in the Hyper-V environment. So we've had a few KeyPress remote desktop issues coming up, but we're back now. So what this has done, this sensibly new machine has now been booted up, in this case from a CD, because the WDS was causing us issues. So we've now booted this from the boot CD that we had. Why it hasn't imported the background?
Do we put the right boot CD in?
That's a good question. We'll find out. I think we did. So it's now booted up. Here we go off and do something sensible. Okay, now this is going to ask us for credentials to connect to the IT Idiots share. So as per before, we would have had trouble if I needed to put in the previous one, so I'm just going to use this one instead.
Yeah, don't have hashes in your admin names. It's, I thought we stopped doing that anyway.
Yeah, I just haven't changed mine back.
But to be so honest, you're paying for it now, aren't you?
I am. I mean, if I'd realised that...
See,
2 years later,
dash, I am.
You don't have rights, do you, because you've locked out your account. I could go and use my hash account to unlock your A account.
Could do.
Okay, so we've now connected up. It's found the...
is that our one, yeah?
Deployment share, that is our one. So, obviously, you calling it Nikki is of no use to you now because only the ISA spaz is showing up. So, we select that task sequence. We hit next, we give it a computer name. So, we'll call this one Nikki 1 just so he gets some mention in this episode. We'll join it into a work group. We don't really want to join this into our domain.
No, I don't think so.
Next, we don't want to enable BitLocker. Next and next. So all of the screens that we had skip would have shown up on here had we not selected skip equals yes.
So they're the applications we blocked out, weren't they?
Yeah, applications, password. Time zones, passwords, etc. So now it's going to go through the task sequence. So now it's obviously formatting the disk.
And this is where from this point on, that's it, isn't it?
This is, I mean, we'll take it so actually when it gets to the install operating system section, and then we'll spin on and that will take quite some time, so we'll do that super fast.
Working fucking IT, does it? Although we have McDonald's every day and stuff, but we labelled it now. No,
they think this is how we work.
Yeah.
Yep, it's a standard Wednesday.
I'm saying, right, it's bedtime, and just get on the table and lie down. It's Tuesday anyway.
Is it?
Yes,
it is.
It is.
We'd be in trouble if it was 9 o'clock on a Wednesday.
It's 9 o'clock on a Wednesday.
People would be phoning us from Malaysia.
Oh God, that's 7 o'clock on a Wednesday.
Was it seven?
Yeah.
Oh dear, so it would have got late anyway. Okay then, so that's taken long enough for us to go and find the nearest McDonald's.
Yep.
Buy the food.
Mm-hmm.
You to have a couple of cigarettes.
Uh-huh.
To come back.
Uh-huh.
Eat the food.
Yep.
And it's just about to come back. So I think that's standard time for doing a deployment.
Yeah.
So I think
McDonald's, isn't it?
Yeah. So it's one McDonald's.
Yeah.
As a technical ISO term. So don't worry about minutes and hours. It's a McDonald's. Okay. So the machine is built. It's now sitting running Windows 7, obviously, as you can see on the screen. It's now going to log on as a local administrator, which is why it's preparing the desktop, which is always going to take a little bit of time.
It also takes ages to prepare, doesn't it?
Yeah, it doesn't really do anything as well. No. It's exactly the same.
Well, exactly. It says that on a core server as well,
yeah.
Which is equally confusing because the desktop is...
There is no desktop. The desktop is non-existent.
Yeah.
Okay, so bang, the desktop looks exactly the same as any desktop. At that, it's all high definition colours and.
But wait, I don't think it's stopped yet.
Well, no, it hasn't. Now you mention it, Nicky, it's logged in as a local administrator and it's run the script again. So, oh look, it's installed in Office.
Wow.
And we haven't asked it to at this. We haven't pressed any buttons at this stage. So you could almost say we've had a very lightly touched deployment. We haven't had to touch
but
it.
I wouldn't spell light the traditional way.
No, no. If I was going to do it, I'd make sure that light was spelt. Without a G or an
H. Yeah, I think so, because that's just confusing.
And with an E as well.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, I mean, that's the way everyone would normally do it. Okay, so the office is going to take quite some time. So we're now weighing up whether we want to spend any longer than 10 minutes waiting for the office installation.
To get an install complete.
So,
I mean, we could botch it.
Yeah, I mean, nobody would know.
No, no.
No, so I mean... We know roughly what it's going to look like. So, one of two things will have happened now, depending on how I edit this. Either it will fade off into the distance with some clever theme music going on, maybe.
I think so, yeah.
With us just chatting about, well, it's Office always installs, there's no problems with that. Or it will cut suddenly and magically.
Thin.
I'm thinking that could be the way forward.
But the nice tone?
Nice tone. But I mean, as you can see, this is now, we've gone through the whole process. Office will install.
We'll install with the service packs.
Install the service packs, and that's why it's going to take quite some time. And we are, quite frankly, running out of time and patience. So I think we're probably going to finish this with a faded off into the distance.
I think so.
And we may give you a screenshot at the end when we come in tomorrow and plug that at the end.
Yeah, or not when up in pain.
Yeah, I'm sure we can do something. But you'll see here, the machine is called...
Well, actually, you can note the time, and we could get the event logs from...
You're sneaky, man. But this is it, really. So, I mean, if we have a quick look, it's 64-bit, because obviously that's what we always intended to do at the start.
Absolutely.
At no point were we going to do a 32-bit install. It's called Nicky One. It's joined the work group as we told it to. Yeah, I mean, that's pretty much... It hasn't activated automatically because we asked it not to.
What you're showing there is just a very, very simple way to get Windows 7 out there on your machines, dealing with multiple different hardware and installing applications, so I'm happy.
Yeah, I mean, there's obviously a lot more we can do. But
yeah, I mean, the big thing which we may lead up to is this whole zero-touch deployment with USMT, but... This serves as a good purpose because we can skip over this part on the next podcast.
Yeah, then we can just assume everyone's read
on the good stuff.
Read this one, watch this one,
watch this one.
And we can move on. But I mean, as I said, I think we'll fade this out.
Yeah.
But hopefully that's not a bad IT Idiots podcast. First one in. How long did we decide it was?
It's got to be 9 months, 8-9 months.
9 months. So as everyone said, I'm not Nick. So if anyone's still got to the end of this thinking I am, I'm definitely not. Although if there's any complaints about me, then yes, I am actually Nick. and all complaints could be directed towards him on his on the IT Idiots Twitter.
Yeah, so twitter.com/ITIdiots for Nick.
Yep.
For Dave, it's...
It's, /DaveM54.
And for me, it's /Nicky C.
So, yeah, feel free to abuse either of the Nicks, but please go easy on me.